Hello and welcome to The Vote here at Latest TV. I'm Mike Mendoza. Today I'm joined by the one and only Mr. Frank LeDuc. Welcome to you.
Hello, thank you very much. Thank you for having me.
It's very awkward having you here because this is a programme that you virtually invented. This was your programme. And suddenly I sort of jumped in there.
Well, it's very nice to be here. It seems strange sitting in my seat, but being a guest, actually.
It is,
but I'll do my best.
Well, you can question me as much as you want, really.
What are you doing sitting there?
A few weeks coming up, of course, once again, council's talking budgets. And for the last few years, it's been up and down. Are we going to have a referendum? How much are we going to increase it? Never talked about cutting, of course, but always, what have we got to cut next? Big announcement today.
Well, yes, the thing that's got people animated this weekend, I think, is just gone, is that we've learnt that youth services look like taking a huge cut in terms of several hundreds of thousands of pounds, possibly 450 grand a year. Well over £1 million over 3 years, and these sounds like big sums of money. What it actually means is the youth clubs, the youth provision throughout the city, things that actually a lot of what they call preventive services are likely to be cut because we don't have to provide them by law as a council. They currently contract them out to the voluntary sector to do a lot of the work for them, and therefore in some respects it's a sort of a relatively easy cut for the council. I say relatively easy, it's all relative.
Is this going to happen throughout the board? We're going to see voluntary sector and grants sort of all drying up now?
Well, I think that's the big worry. I mean, a lot of people in the voluntary sector have actually spent the past sort of 3-4 weeks working really hard on putting together their bid for some work for the next 3 years, helping to provide youth services throughout the city. And, and these are things that they might include counselling, mentor work, youth clubs, after school stuff, keeping kids off the streets, doing constructive activity, and providing support for those who've got sort of who are going through uncertain times in their teens, and a lot of this work is actually targeted in the places it's most needed across Brighton and Hove as well. So some of the poorer parts of the area are likely to feel this and some other cuts coming at the same time from other directions, all having a cumulative effect really. So there's a lot of anxiety around, both people providing the services and indeed among some of the people who are on the receiving end.
Well, do you think the government should perhaps step in here? Are we going to hear more from our local MPs?
I wouldn't be surprised if we hear more from a couple of them. One of them is in a very difficult position because he's a government minister, Simon Kirby, and it's very difficult, even if he wanted to speak out and criticise, and he may want to, he may not, I don't know, but even if he did, he has to take collective responsibility with the government for whatever they decide, whatever actions they do. So he's sort of, I said his hands are sort of tied. He can make representations behind the scenes, and I know from past experience that on certain issues where he believes it's a strong constituency matter that does happen. He doesn't always make a song and dance about it, and perhaps he should, but he doesn't. But certainly I think Caroline Lucas, who is an opposition MP as a Green, and perhaps Peter Kyle as well, who as a Labour MP is the same political stripe as the council, may
that's
find
difficult.
It can be, yes.
The council could put this down, of course, to lack of government funding.
I mean, if I were leading a Labour council in Brighton and Hove right now, I'd be pointing the finger at the Conservatives running the government. And one area where you could probably say they're justified in doing this is that the government effectively sets the ceiling on how much the council can spend. It sets the ceiling on how much the council can raise, whether it's through grant from central government or even the council tax. The council can only put the council tax up by a certain amount, or it must hold a referendum. And I think that very few councils around the country have had the courage to hold a referendum, because I think there's only been one, and it was a no. I don't think there's a great appetite for even bigger council tax bills. For a lot of people, that's a very big bill.
Of course,
But it is, so it's the government that sets the budget. And I guess, Mike, what I just add to that is that we had the autumn statement a week ago, or if we're going out when I think we are. So we had the autumn statement on Wednesday the 23rd of November, and it's after that that the councils begin to hear, get a clearer picture from the government of how much they're going to get from the government. It's a reducing sum each year, and they're really struggling to try to work out how to make their money work. Government departments themselves are not facing the same level of reductions as local councils, but not by a long way. Local councils have really taken the big hit at the same time as being given more things to do by law. So they're caught between a rock and a hard place, really. And I don't suppose sort of hacks like me normally sort of are naturally sympathetic to councils and etc. But I do think they've got the devil's own job at the moment, trying to sort of make their make the books balance.
Yeah. Well, with the Brexit vote, of course, there's what, 300 million a week coming back into the coffers, so surely we should be quite well off.
We haven't left yet. And I don't think, I mean, on one level, we will be paying less to Brussels. If there is what's called a hard Brexit, if we actually leave clean break, then yes, we won't be paying contributions towards Brussels and the European Union. If we, however, stay in the single market, or if we have an access agreement to trade with the single market, then there is every likelihood, actually, we will be paying a sum of money to Brussels for that access, so that we might not be saving as much as some people thought.
It's a Brexit as opposed to an exit.
Well, I'm not sure quite.
So, I mentioned before, yeah, we're going to see that more of the voluntary sector losing their funding. So how do they survive?
Well, one of the difficulties, and one of the reasons why there will be a lot of anxiety at the moment among the people who run these voluntary groups, community groups, which are, you know, by and large set up as charities, will be that if they get what's called core funding from the council, often in exchange for a contract to provide services like the Youth Commission, then they can go and attract funding from the lottery or other sources, bringing money in from outside Brighton & Hove to help young people here with whatever it is they're providing, you see. And I think without that core funding, this other money is at risk too. So although the council might save £450,000 in the next financial year, 1.3 million over 3 years, what you're going to have actually is charities losing not just 450 grand in the coming year, but possibly twice as much, because they'll lose, if not in the coming year, certainly the year after or the year after that, they'll lose that other funding they're getting from outside. So it's a big hit.
Yeah. I might be naive, but if it's voluntary, why do they need so much money?
Because although they're voluntary organisations, and they do rely on volunteer, I mean, Community Works, for example, which is the kind of umbrella group for the charities and community groups across the city, has something like, I think, about 8 full-time equivalent staff, but a team of about 80 volunteers doing an incredible amount of support work for hundreds and hundreds of charities that, you know, if you or I set up a sort of, you know, a street group to help people in our street because we knew there were sort of people in need, we probably don't have the legal expertise or the financial expertise or premises to meet in and stuff like that. And these are the things where you can go to Community Works and ask for help. They might provide some things themselves or point you in the right direction to services. So they basically sort of help plug the gaps so that voluntary groups and charities can operate effectively and be governed properly. You know, we want to, if you're giving to charity, you want to know your money's being looked after.
Sure. Yeah.
And managed well. And so, but you know, again, if you're providing, I don't know, daycare for old people, you want to make sure, you might have volunteers sort of helping with that rota, but you might want somebody who's actually managing that service day in, day out, coordinating all the volunteers to make sure it actually happens, so that someone's not just left high and dry, you know, one day because there's no volunteers left.
The last few years have been the threat of referendum.
Yeah.
It hasn't actually gone to that yet. Can you see that happening this time?
No, I don't think so.
Really?
I don't think there's an appetite. It costs money to hold one of these things. It costs about, we're told, about £1 million to hold,
really?
To hold a referendum.
That's £1 million off the budget.
Yeah. My gut feeling is that sounds a little high for me, but you will have to print ballot papers. You'll have to get legal advice on what the question should be. I would like to think that will come from inside the council, but they'll have to consult with the government as well about what the form of the questioning will be. You'll have to get these ballot papers distributed. Some people want a postal vote. You'll have polling stations on the day of the referendum. It's not like we've got any other elections coming up next May when it'll have to be held either.
So they'd like to link the two together, don't they?
If there were elections taking place anyway, you could at least sort of, you know, combine the costs a little, some economies of scale, if you like, but that's not going to happen. I don't see it.
If there was a referendum and people say no, which you said has happened before in other areas.
Bristol, I think.
So what happens then? They've got to go back and readjust the budget again.
They've got to stick with, they've got to go.
So the cuts are going to be there anyway.
Yeah, and I think that's the fear that will happen. I mean, the Green Party, when they were in office, talked about going down this route, but equally we've never had a party that's had a majority in the city for quite some time. So even if the Greens had wanted to do that, and even if this year Labour wants to do it this coming year, actually they'd need to get the agreement of the other two parties, and I think that's unlikely. They'd need at least one of them on board.
Yeah.
So I don't think it's likely. I don't think the Greens want to help them particularly.
So I mean, you speak to Warren Morgan occasionally.
We have spoken.
You have spoken.
Right here in the council chamber.
I'm just wondering how he handles this and whether he really feels I should ever take this job on.
It's very difficult. I think, you know, he's a very different character to Jason Kitcat, who held the job before. He's a different character to Bill Randall, who held the job before. To Mary Mears, who held the job before that. But each of them, I think, I think it's fair to say each of them took their role and their responsibilities very seriously. They're not, I think it's ever so easy as a sort of people looking on to this sort of political Game of Thrones to think that it is all treated as a game. But, yeah, these are people who, in my experience, and I think Warren Morgan is one of these, who takes what he's doing very seriously, tries his best for Brighton and Hove, and obviously for his party, but I think he thinks more widely than just his party. I think he's thinking about what we need here to make the city work, right from things like rejuvenating our seafront, because it's our tourist magnet, it really is, to the things like worrying about can we afford to pay all the social workers we need to look after
those. We'll talk about that a lot more after the break, if that's okay with you. You're watching The Vote here at Latest TV. I'm Mike Mendoza. This is Frank LeDuc. We'll be back after the break. Don't go away. Back very soon. Welcome back to The Vote here at Latest TV. I'm Mike Mendoza, joined still by Frank LeDuc. We tried to kick him out, but he kept coming back in again.
So like a bad penny.
The one thing very interesting, when the Greens, I think, guessed they were going to lose power, they tried to push for as many things as possible, environmentally, I guess, and various schemes. One of those, of course, was Vanley Gardens. When Labour came in, the first thing they said was, we're not going ahead with that, we don't like that idea at all. And now we've heard, what, in the last week, this has now been virtually put aside.
Well, I know this is an unfashionable thing to say, but to be fair to the Greens, I think they tried to push a lot of things through when they were in office, and I think they tried to push through a lot of things they genuinely believed in. And
they believe in everything.
There's a real division in Brighton and Hove, I think. We've got three parties who are, you know, at various times almost equal in size in the number of seats they hold on the council. It doesn't vary much. And Labour and the Greens seem to swing at the moment. But I think that reflects the fact that we've got a city where we've got, you know, about 40-45% of the population who are pretty sort of conservative-ish, even certainly with a small C and often with a big C, and probably about 55% who are sort of Labour or Green and who switch at time to time. And I think there's probably some of those in the middle who switch anyway.
So Lib Dems don't feature in this at all?
I think people who probably were, there are some Lib Dems, but I think the people, not on the council though, I think those who were have either probably either sitting on their hands or backing one of the other parties, probably Greens or Labour, probably Labour last election, possibly Greens the election before. But yeah, they're sort of, Lib Dems are not a force to be reckoned with at the moment, but they're promising a revival, we'll see. So Valley Gardens, well, I think the Greens picked up on a scheme actually that, funnily enough, Labour promoted in 2006, 2007, when Jill Mitchell was doing the job she's doing now, looking after the environment brief, transport. And she was the front woman for this scheme in what we call Valley Gardens, which is sort of between St Peter's Church and the sea, really. So sort of what I think of as the old steam.
Yeah, all the way down to the Palace Pier, actually. Yeah.
Absolutely. Mm. And I'm glad you called it that.
I couldn't call it anything other than the Palace Pier.
I know, it's the Palace Pier. Yeah. It's the Palace Pier.
It's got its name back, hasn't it? It's back.
I hope so. Yes, I hope so. So this is an area where the traffic jams up, where it's, you know, we've got a green lung there in a way, but it probably doesn't feel like it when you breathe the, you know, unless there's a very strong sea breeze, you're often breathing sort of fumes, it seems there. So for a long time, the council and under different colours have wanted to make that a better place, make it a better route in and out of the city, and certainly make it a nicer place to stop and you know.
So doing away with the roundabout and putting a set of traffic lights in will ease congestion, surely not.
I don't know if that will be, I have a strong suspicion that won't be the final outcome of this scheme. But when Labour pressed pause on winning office in May last year, they said that they wanted to do, I didn't think they thought the traffic projections were credible, because a lot of things were changing, like the work going on at the hospital up Eastern Road, Circus Street, the building that was going to go up there for you know, a lot more student homes, some flats for others, some stuff for the university as well, teaching rooms. I think with all the changes going on, they felt that actually the traffic projections weren't credible and they need to look at it again. And there were some junctions where, when the scheme was originally sold to the council, when the Greens were in office, the scheme looked one way, and when it came back for sign-off, some changes have been made to the junctions, which actually, I think anybody who's ever tried to drive in or out Brighton would have said, you're going to get a snarl up there, because you haven't got enough space at the junctions for cars to turn right at a couple of the junctions, by St Peter's Church, bottom of Edward Street. And so the new scheme, you'd think it'd be nice and simple just to sort that out, wouldn't you? But I don't know why it never is. It never is. So now they've gone back. They've rechecked the traffic numbers. That they are different. There is evidence to suggest they need to think again about the changes they want to. And the reason they have to go through all this evidence, if you like, before they can finally sign it off, is to satisfy the various people they get the funding from, which includes our local enterprise partnership, Coastal Capital, who themselves are passing on money from the Department for Transport and other bits of the government. So we've got 8 million quid riding on this that's coming to the council from outside. And we've already had 2.8 million of it. It's ring-fenced, it's sitting there. We can't spend it on anything else. And if we don't do this project, we've got to give it back. And we'll lose another...
There's no loss, though, is it?
Well,
I mean, that money
was
for a particular project that a lot of people don't like, so therefore give them the money back and don't do the project.
I know. I think when you see these projects criticised, a lot of people say, well, spend the money on something else then. And actually, it's not as simple as that.
Money's because earmarked for that.
The money, the government will give you the money only if you spend it on what you bid for. And if you can't provide that, you forego the money. You just have to,
Which is fair enough.
Absolutely, but it's not a simple...
Well, so you're confident the roundabout will stay and there'll be no traffic lights at the junction? A roundabout that's been there for a couple of hundred years.
Has it really? No.
It feels that way. I feel that old.
If I were a betting man, I would say that I'd say the roundabout will stay.
By the way, I've seen pictures of a horse and cart going around there, so it has been there a long time.
Oh, recently, was this?
Well, very old photos of Brighton by the pier.
Yeah, no, indeed.
The aquarium when it was first built.
Well, indeed, it's been. Mm. You're probably right. It's probably been there about a century at least, and. It's always been a busy junction. I mean, the only thing, a few centuries ago, that was kind of like some marshland out there, and you know, that was if a river flowed through Brighton, the Wellesbourne, that's where it came out to sea there, sort of pool valley there.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Yeah, that was, you know, it was the low point. But now it, you know, any small thing clogs that place up, and we need. While we don't want to, you know, the council doesn't want to encourage too much traffic, equally it does need the traffic we do get to flow as far as possible.
Okay, so we'll watch this space and see what they decide to do. Mentioned there about three parties.
Yeah.
Why do you think UKIP has never got a foot into Brighton Hove yet on the West? They're very, very strong. In fact, they're the second biggest party in West Sussex Council. They're the second biggest party on Ada District Council. They've got seats in Worthing Council, but nothing at all in Brighton Hove.
Well, I suppose, Brighton is this kind of sort of slightly, you know, sort of liberal with a small L kind of place, broadly speaking. I mean, not all, but the majority of Conservatives in Brighton and Hove, for example, on the council, I would say were probably socially liberal. And I think that's in keeping with the area. I don't think, I mean, we often hear Brighton's a fairly diverse place, but actually, to be honest, if you go to London, Brighton is a fairly white, middle-class sort of place, really, to be honest. The last census shows that we're pushing, you know, almost 20% of the population that showed up in the census is not sort of, if you like, white British, but a lot of those are white European, so white Polish people, etc., and from Eastern Europe, so or people are from Spain. You know, we're not really as multicultural and diverse as we sometimes think we are. Certainly, when it comes to nationalities and ethnicities, but although we have changed.
Although most of Sussex voted Brexit, didn't they? But not Brighton and Hove.
No, indeed. I think part of the reason Brighton is not particularly UKIP friendly, if you like, is because there is a good mix. I mean, more of a mix, I suspect, here than in some other parts of Sussex that you've mentioned. And so I think people just sort of generally see, you know, they see the value of people coming here from other parts of the world, either to work. I mean, our NHS locally would collapse without the people we recruit from the Philippines, from India, from Spain, Portugal and Ireland. Our hospital goes out and actively recruits from those countries because we can't staff the positions from our own, you know, from people who are born and raised and educated here. So, you know, I think I always laugh when I hear about the trying to charge people for using our NHS when they come from abroad, because actually here we desperately rely on Brighton and Hove, on people coming from abroad to work in the NHS as well. So I don't know. I think UKIP probably find more fertile soil elsewhere, but they don't have so much, so much contact with people. Or when there's ghettoisation, you don't have ghettoisation here either.
I mean, if and when Brexit does happen, will that really make UKIP defunct, do you think?
Well, it'll achieve its aim then, won't it, in a way? But I don't know. I mean, I think they would like to try to reinvent themselves and appeal more widely, you know, to dis, 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 disgruntled Labour supporters in the north, disgruntled Conservatives more in the south. I don't see.
One of the big arguments is that when you look at the number of seats the SNP's got in Parliament, UKIP actually got nearly three times the amount of votes they did.
And they've got one seat, one MP. I know, and it's the way, and again, in this country, with first past the post, it's the way the votes are distributed. And in Scotland, there's a huge concentration of votes in a sort of relatively small number of seats, so in about 60 seats, and the SNP have got most of those. Obviously, we had an SNP councillor in Brighton once, a long time ago. Well, he was a Labour councillor who defected.
Okay, before we go, let's have a quick chat about train strike. Oh. More dates have been announced.
More train strikes, yes.
Not looking good over to Christmas, New Year.
Well, ASLEF are going to start. The train drivers belong to a union called ASLEF mostly, and they've announced 9 days of strikes starting from Tuesday the 13th of December and finishing on Saturday the 14th of January. So during that period, there will be 9 days when train drivers are on strike. That's on top of the 9 days of strikes by members of the RMT union, who are the guards or conductors, or as Southern and Govey attended.
If they strike, the drivers won't be able to work.
Absolutely. Well, certainly if the drivers strike, the trains aren't going anywhere. Increasingly, the Southern wants the guards to become onboard supervisors, and that means trains can go without them. If they can. I mean, this is what the whole argument's about, whether they're needed or not. And of course, they're worried if they're not needed, eventually they'll all lose their jobs. They're fighting for their jobs. I mean, they're pinning it on safety, and the drivers say it's a safety issue too, but actually, as well, it is about people's jobs at the end of the day.
And what's going to happen? We've got driverless trains and everything is just automatically done by robots.
I think that's going to be a long way in the future. I mean, who knows? Docklands Light Railway already have it. I think it'll be a long time before we've got it on our networks.
And at Gatwick, going between the two terminals there, no drivers at all of those. Frank, thanks a lot for popping in. Nice to see you. Frank Duke's been our guest today on The Vote, and Frank is back next week with hundreds of editions of The Vote himself anyway. As he throws me out the studio for a change. Anyway, thanks a lot for your company. We'll see you again very, very soon. Bye for now. Thank you.